Good morning, everyone, and thanks for being here for the final of four clinical webinars that the National Cannabis Prevention and Information Centre, or NCPIC, has hosted during June and July. My name is John, and I'm a research assistant in the clinical training team, and I'll be introducing you to today's presenter. I will also be moderating the question time at the end of the presentation. So please type through any questions you would like answered by today's presenter while the talk progresses. In the last 3 weeks, we've introduced the Quitting Cannabis 1-6 sessions, which is a standardized brief intervention based on CBT for predominantly treatment-seeking clients. Today, our presenter will take you through the final stages of this intervention. This webinar series is presented by Etty Matalon. Etty is the clinical training manager of the workforce development team here at NCPIC and has been our lead trainer for the past 7 years. Welcome, Etty.
Hi, John. Sounds very impressive every time you say it. Hi, and welcome back to, as John said, our last webinar series. I just want to go back to a question that someone asked last week, and it was about what happens when clients don't bring their books back to the session, which is seriously very often the case. They are forgetful. But what you might do is obviously have a copy with you and still go through those sections during the session that you have with them. And if they have filled it out and have done their homework, they will remember what they've written in it. So even if they forget that book or their book, that's okay. Just pick up another one and just go through the various sections. So please feel free just to ask any questions about things such as that. And I think that was a really, really good question because that has happened in my clinical experience. Okay. Now, as you know, we're doing Quitting Cannabis 1-6 sessions. Again, as John said, it is for treatment seekers. We have other interventions that are for non-treatment seekers, but this one is for someone who puts their hand up and says, yes, I need to talk to you about this, I need to do something about it. And as you know, we used Tony as an example. So last week, we covered strategies for change in sections 3 and 4, which was about really developing some strategies for change. We looked at the monitor sheet, we coached Tony on some cognitive restructuring, we taught some self-talk, we talked about that, we talked about thoughts and how they relate to our behaviours. We established some support systems, we explained what the 4 Ds are and how to use them, and as many other Ds as you can think of. We explained urge management, talked about the stray cat and the wave, and we raised the issue about owning your own decisions and what that meant. We developed an emergency plan, or at least that was set down for homework, discussed behavioural self-management, explained limit setting, and so on. And we talked about lifestyle changes. Now, this component, as I said last week, could take, 2 or 3 sessions. So it is the heart of the change and hopefully one that's maintained. Okay. Now this week we're going to be covering section 5 and 6. It's kind of a summary and putting it all together and reviewing things and see how things are going and thinking ahead a little bit about relapse and relapse prevention. Now, again, I'm just wanting to remind those listeners that may have not been with us for the whole time, or at least perhaps not with us in the first session or the first webinar. I just talked about some reference books that we would highly recommend that you have, and these are the two. Another one is, if you're in the mental health field, is highly recommended by us. It's the monograph that the health department put out some time ago. And of course, our website. This is our website. It's had a bit of a facelift, if you're not familiar with this look. So this is what it looks like now. And obviously this is the source of your ordering any resources, particularly the one on Quitting Cannabis 1-6 sessions, and obviously any NCPIC information I do urge you to go onto our mailing list, and don't forget to refer your clients to our website. And of course, as you know, there's a wealth of information. It's a one-stop shop in relation to cannabis. The last book that I want to refer to, or reference book, is our guidelines, our clinical guidelines. They are available on our website. And this is all about evidence-based information. It will give you the evidence for what's been found to be successful in relation to cannabis. Things on screening tools, assessment tools, interventions, and so on. So again, please download that if you'd like. All right, let's now move on to section 5, which is about putting it all together. It's kind of like a summary of everything that's gone on. And again, you can take 6 sessions with your client, you can take 4 sessions with your client, you can take 10 sessions with your client, depending on how much needs to be done with him. So you need to review the weeks and fine-tune what you've already discussed and any areas that really need to be kind of bedded down a bit more. Now, what your client or what Tony has to do is really be prepared mentally. That's about having a positive outlook. Being prepared mentally is about being mindful. It's about making sure that Tony's not in automatic, that he's actually aware of what's going on and making an effort to put these things that you talk about in practice. It's being prepared and knowing what to expect. I like to say, or I like to use this phrase, which is, I'm sure some of you have already heard it, fail to plan and plan to fail. People really need, A, to know what is going to happen and what they feel, or what you know, how they should feel through their withdrawal or whatever. So you may want to ask Tony something like, okay, Tony, so how are things going so far? How do you think things are going for you? Do you feel prepared? You know, do you feel prepared enough to maintain this change that you've decided to implement? Is there anything that I can clarify for you or that we can go over? You might say something like, you know, the change does need to be lacking in stress and be as hassle-free as it can. So I'm just checking in with you just to cover off anything that you might be feeling, you know, doubtful about or not clear about before we end our time together. Now, this conversation may take 20 minutes, 30 minutes. It may take the entire sessions to go over, you know, to go back 3 spaces. So you really need to feel confident that he's understood everything. And if he hasn't been able to implement some of the things you suggested, you really need to, you know, work through why that's been. So as I said, the conversation may take anywhere, you know, between 15, 20, 30 minutes. So you need to give reassurances. Now, in the event that your client has not yet chosen a quit date, or you are meeting some resistance, because we all rationalize certain things that we're not ready to kind of embrace. So in the event that your client is kind of dodging the quit date, you may need to have a discussion around rationalization. There is no such thing as perfection. There is no such thing as a perfect time. Of course, there are moments in time that are more conducive to change than others. That's a given. And there are times when it's not conducive to change. So you really need to check if you're feeling some resistance, that, you know, what's happening here, what is going on. And it has been my experience that if I feel that there is resistance from week to week, I'm quite happy to say, look, this may not be the right time for you, and that's okay. We talk about that and why it might not be and what to do when the right time does come. So if you're feeling that, then you need to address it. You can't just keep on going and assuming it isn't happening. Sorry, I just had to clear my throat. So just be aware of some resistance and rationalizations about, you know, not the perfect time. So because Tony or your client might be saying things to himself like, oh, what should I do? Should I? I know I want to, but I'm too busy. Just one last smoke. This is a special occasion. I'll just have one more. As I said, this is a special occasion, and after that I'll stop. I've been working really hard. I deserve a reward. You know, then you need to say, okay, Tony, you know, that's all right. It appears that you're kind of, we've been talking to each other now for the last 3 or 4 weeks. You haven't quite chosen a quit date or a reduction date. Now, okay, we need to go back 3 spaces. Let's go back and revisit why you wanted to make this change. You talked about, you know, having more money and having a clearer head. So let's just focus for a little while on the benefits of these things. You said to me that you wanted more money to do stuff. Do you remember what you told me that you were wishing to do? What you're trying to do by asking that question is you're allowing Tony to evoke change talk, just to go back to, go back to the reasons why he came to see you and why he wants to make this change. You might say something like, you also said that you wanted more money for a holiday. Do you remember what you said to me about that holiday? Again, you are trying to evoke change talk. So the suggestion is to continue with that discussion, or a discussion such as this, should you meet resistance. In other words, as I just said, you need to go back 2 spaces. So check for rationalizations in case a person has not chosen their quit date, you know, within 3 or 4 sessions. And if you're feeling resistance, when you're feeling resistance, you really do need to go back 2, 3, 4 spaces and review what that's about. Okie dokie. Now, it's very important, the next discussion that you have is about separation and loss. Very important that you explain the feelings that may come up for your client, and for example, for Tony. It's about feeling that something is missing, or, you know, there's a hole that needs to be fixed. You might say something, look, giving up smoking may feel like you've lost someone that you really loved or cared about. Can we look at this for a minute? You really do need to talk about, and I suppose, for want of a better word, normalize this. You know, cannabis has played such an important part in a person's life, and stopping it, you know, for any length of time may really feel like a loss. So you do need to talk about it and reassure your client that this happens with most people. And you may give the example of say, cigarette smoking. When people give up cigarettes, they feel like they've given up their best friend. So reassure Tony that such feelings do pass. Again, choose your own words, but I might say something like, look, Tony, just be aware that this might happen. And if it does, you know, try and do something that you find enjoyable to kind of relieve that feeling of loss or negativity. And, you know that even though it may take some time, that it will pass. You can, you know, if you continue on, you will begin to feel the benefits, and that lack of that hole may start to become smaller, even though, you know, it does feel like grief and loss in some respects. You need to review the progress. You need to review where he's come and how far he's come. So Don't let negativity in, as it says there. If you, again, very much like what we spoke about last week, the ABC theory, you know, that belief and those thoughts will determine what you end up doing. So if you let those negative thoughts come in, then it will end badly. So you need to shore up that self-talk. You need to shore up, you know, thinking positively and looking at the progress and looking at how far he's gone. Hopefully he has, if all, you know, things are put into place and, you know, his level of readiness is there and so on, then things should progress relatively easy. And as I said many times, readiness fluctuates. So you've constantly got to be checking in. How you feeling? Are we progressing, you know, the way you wanted? Are we going too fast? Is everything okay? Because readiness does fluctuate from week to week, as we've said. So it's about suggesting to Tony that he does need to be mindful. And as I just said, you know, it's about owning his own decisions. It's like, it's about being in the moment. You know, what are you thinking? How are you feeling? What's going to help that situation? You need to own the change. Tony, you need to be proud of the changes that you're making and the effort that you're making. This is all about you and what you're doing. So, you know, look to the positive. Think about how far you've come so far, how much you've learned about triggers, internal, external, and so on. So you might want to review all of that. So reviewing progress, you might say, look, you know, you've gone from no to, oh, maybe I do want to make a change, to yes, I do want to make a change. And you've rung and you've come in and we've talked about it. And you've told me how much, you know, you've been enjoying going to the beach with the kids, how you've seen your withdrawals reduce over the last 2 weeks. So again, you need to check for those symptoms and reassure him that it's, you know, perfectly normal to feel these things. This is withdrawal, and you've gone over that. You've told me that your breathing has improved considerably over the last couple of weeks. So you really need to help the client see these things, because if you ask a question, and it's been my experience when I've said, okay, so you haven't smoked for the last 2 or 3 weeks. Can you tell me, you know, some of the benefits that you feel that you've gained by not smoking these last 2 weeks? And honestly, they'll go, I don't know. And I have to prize it out of them. I have to say, okay, so is there less conflict? Oh, yeah. Okay, have you enjoyed yourself on the weekend a bit more? Yeah. Are you breathing a bit better? Oh, yeah. Are you sleeping a bit better? Oh, yeah. And so, you know, they're just not used to thinking in a positive frame of mind. So I think it's really important that you kind of go through that with them and try to hone in on the positives of their experience. And hopefully they have. Because if they haven't experienced any positives, then it's unlikely that it will continue. Human beings do not continue to behave unless there is some positive reward. That's really, really important. As I think I've mentioned, you know, the carrot stick. We will continue to engage in behaviour that is positively rewarding. So you perhaps need to go back to the monitor sheet and, you know, maybe you need to look at, you know, what he's thinking, what is going on, help coach him a bit. So the monitor sheet is a really useful insight into what's going on and how effective he's being in terms of changing those thoughts and those beliefs. And the mastery rating, you know, will give you a really good idea of his headspace and how he's going. So use the monitor sheets to see how he's progressing. You can also use the monitor sheets that may throw up new situations that have developed from 1 week to another. And so there might be new ones that you need to develop new strategies around. And it definitely, I think I did touch on one of the clients that we had in the trial that came in one of the weeks was something completely new that we hadn't thought about. So we had to develop some strategies around those. So that kind of doesn't really stop. But what you have done in making these suggestions about some strategies is allowing the client to realise that there are things that they can do for developing strategies for other high-risk situations. And let's just, for example, say, you know, Tony realised that one of the guys at work was really annoying him and, you know, it's a trigger for him to raise this anger. He just rubs him the wrong way and it just makes him think of, I know what fixes, you know, how when I feel like this, I know what fixes it, it's smoking. So rather than dwell on that, you know, you can talk about he has choices. He can walk out the door when he starts to irritate him and annoy him. He can do something else to take his mind off the guy who's annoying him. He just needs to do it. He just needs to do whatever helps. Then we talked about change talk. He has to change his self-talk. And hopefully you might use this opportunity to coach him yet again on what self-talk is all about and how to moderate it, how to neutralize it and perhaps even turn it into positive self-talk. And, you know, he might want to imagine himself screaming back at him just to I don't know, make him feel that, you know, he just vented. You know, I'm not suggesting that everyone should do this. I'm just saying that this is another alternative. But you need to go through. You are like a coach and make some suggestions and then decide, the both of you, on what might help in this new high-risk situation. So the new high-risk situation needs discussion and strategies need to be agreed upon, as I've just said. You know, other suggestions in other high-risk situations might be things like, you know, don't see certain friends for a while until you feel that you've mastered this or that you're in more, you know, that you're in control. Take up a sport or something that's completely opposite to going home and sitting on the couch and smoking. An exercise or anything in that kind of vein that is opposite to smoking is a good suggestion. Anyway, so if you feel you need to, go back to the monitor sheet. If you feel you need to because high-risk situation or a new high-risk situation comes up, you need to develop some strategies for that high-risk situation. So that's really what I'm trying to remind you to do. Okay, so let's go back to the positives. Again, carrot and stick. We don't engage in behaviour that is not intrinsically rewarding. So you need to go back to, okay, what are some of the good things? Now, you know, have you been able to save more money or do you have more money now that you're not spending $150 a week on cannabis? So do you have more money to maybe go out for a nice dinner? That would be nice. And don't forget to pay the babysitter. I love that one. I just thought that was so good. Or perhaps buy yourself a new tie to go to work. You mentioned these desert boots a few weeks ago. Perhaps you might, you know, splurge out and spend that $150 on a new pair of desert boots. You were telling me that you wanted to take the boy. Oh, what happened then? Sorry. I don't know what happened then. There we go. You mentioned that you wanted to take the boys out to Manly on the ferry. So again, you might want to have a day out. So you need to encourage rewards from week to week, from the time that they stop smoking. And in Tony's case, hopefully it was like 2 or 3 weeks ago. You need to talk about rewarding themselves, not just $150 worth, but on a day-to-day basis. And again, this is why you go back to, okay, what are the benefits that you've felt since you've stopped smoking? And then encourage long-term rewards for the hard work, because it is not easy to change behaviour. And, you know, some of the best ways, if he loses focus, some of the best ways to kind of maintain focus is to keep referring back to the decisional balance and why he wanted to make these changes. Go back to, as we said, the negatives of smoking and the positives of change. You know, a two-sided summary. So as I said, one of the best ways to maintain focus is to refer back to that decisional balance and why Tony wanted to make those changes. Now, just make sure, because this may be undermining some of the stuff that you're trying to do, so just make sure that better coping skills are in place, or at least that some work has begun in relation to what you've identified as, you know, needing some work side by side with the cannabis. So you might help them, send them somewhere else, or a book or something that relates to, say, anger management or, you know, communication skills, whether, you know, they're finding it difficult to communicate generally or at work or be more assertive or at home. And sleep hygiene is really, really important. As we said last week, a lot of people use cannabis to put them to sleep, or help them sleep, even though it actually is not a restful sleep. It interferes with REM and so on. So help them establish some good habits to replace the old habit of smoking before they go to bed. That, you know, again, as you can see, a lot of time is needed. A lot of detail that needs to be gone into in relation to the new things that, you know, Tony might have to learn in order to maintain this change and in order for him to feel the benefits of this change. So, again, as you're summarising, going back to what's worked and how it's going, and, you know, making sure that you've bedded down all of these things and that you're confident to kind of let him go on out there on his own, that all these things have been discussed and are in place. You know, we talked about lifestyle changes. You need to review these lifestyle changes and make sure that they're in place. You asked him a few weeks ago to make some inquiries and to see how much these things cost that he wanted to engage in. And if he hasn't done any of that, you want to know why not. If he hasn't, why not? He talked about joining a cricket team. He talked about a football team, or perhaps, you know, wanting to take art classes, cooking classes, or even cooking when he came home to just shift his mind, you know, get recipes from the internet or whatever, joining an athletics team or even going out for a walk or a run by himself, taking up music, whatever he used to do that he loved that he hasn't done for ages. So these are all necessary to make a person feel good about what they're doing and the changes they've made. I mean, people change for a reason, and hopefully is a better quality of life. So, you know, he needs to put these in place to replace this kind of hole or mind space. And if he hasn't, then why hasn't he? Because, as I've said, or as you need to suggest, that if nothing changes, then nothing changes. And it makes it so much harder to change a habit if you haven't made changes in your life and you're still in automatic. These changes, you know, help fill the void. They increase positive feelings, not just physiologically, but you know, mentally as well, because it increases self-control and self-confidence. And they need to be fun. They need to be things that are enjoyable to him. And obviously, physical exercise, we know, reduces stress and it may well be one of the ways in which you kind of like, you know, chills out. So these things really need to be, as I said, bedded down and put into place before he leaves you. So once you feel confident that these things are in place, you need to move on to relapse prevention. And again, you need to discuss and educate Tony, because I suspect that he's probably lapsed or relapsed a few times. And I think that we covered, I think in the first week, you know, relapse and lapsing and why he lapsed and what was going on and what strategies worked in the past and what didn't work in the past. So you needed to have, or you need to set down for homework that he read this part of the book, and he needs to understand the difference between a lapse, which is a one-off, and a relapse, which is basically going back to the same amount that he used to smoke, again, on an ongoing basis. And reassure him that one swallow does not a summer make. So in other words, one cigarette or one puff or, you know, a slight lapse does not mean that it's all lost, nor does it's the same as one drop of rain mean that it's a storm coming. He can choose. He needs to be, again, mindful of what he's doing. You've also got in the book, or you've developed with him, or he's developed for himself, which you've checked, an emergency plan, which he needs to put into place. But the most important thing that you have to convey is that lapsing is not failing. It is not a pass or fail. Change life in general is not a pass or fail. It's not an exam. We all learn through various attempts at making changes until we are successful. And it's, as I said, extremely important to convey that this is not failure, because clients very often are so used to beating themselves up. Their esteem is very often shattered. So any negative, it's a black or white thinking. It is, I failed, I'm an idiot, I'm useless, may as well give up. So really it's about giving them reassurances that it is not failure. And I'll go on to talk about normalising it in some way. But really I just want to stress the point that you need to make sure that they understand that it is not. It's simply a mistake. It's not failure. I'm just going to put on a little video for you, so just to break up the sound of my own voice.
All right, so we're kind of nearly at the tail end here, but let's spend a few minutes thinking about the future and what might happen.
What do you mean? What might happen?
Well, you're doing really well, but what might happen is you might have a lapse. That's not quite the same as a relapse. We differentiate a lapse from a relapse. Do you have any idea what I mean by that?
Not really, but a relapse sounds worse.
Sort of. A lapse is having one smoke or lighting up a joint. It's kind of like a one-off. However, a relapse means that you've gone back to the same amount that you used to smoke. So whether that's 2-3 times a day or 4-5 times on each day over the weekend. Whereas a lapse is just a minor glitch.
Okay, I get it.
So now what you need to do when you have a lapse is to decide whether you will turn a lapse into a relapse.
Huh? What does that mean?
Having your one-off may revert you to your old smoking patterns of daily smoking, or kidding yourself by saying, yeah, one won't hurt, or, you know, I need to reward myself. Things like that.
Ah, I see what you mean. Okay.
So can you describe in your own words what a lapse and a relapse means for you?
I guess what you're saying is just because I smoke a one-off, it doesn't mean I need to continue to smoke and that all the work I've done is lost. I need to make sure that I don't keep sliding and continue to smoke. That's, you know, what's been really hard for me in the past.
Yeah, I'm sure it has. Remember, a lapse doesn't mean failure, okay? This is why we have to set up an emergency plan. You need to be prepared and see that you are in control of what you do. How you feel and, you know, what you chose to think of when you are in a vulnerable situation like that. Can you give this some thought while filling this out?
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, so when you notice that you're smoking, remember, only you can make the decision of what to do next. Continue to smoke or put your emergency plan into action. Can you think of any reason why you wouldn't go to your book, pick it up, read it, or engage in the emergency plan?
I guess if I just get overwhelmed and can't handle the urge, or maybe I'll feel kind of hopeless or just like giving up.
Okay, then you need to pick up the phone straight away. Either ring me or the helpline or a friend or anyone that knows what's going on and can distract you until you can actually think things through properly.
Okay, that's doable.
So let's develop an emergency plan, a plan that is easy for you to implement and one that you are likely to put into action.
All right.
Great. Okay, I hope you've enjoyed our little animations. Do you like how the pad just appears and disappears off his lap? I like that. I thought it was very creative. Anyway, now I've just made this last webinar a little bit shorter than the others simply because I want to leave time for some questions, which I think are really useful because, you know, they may be questions that other people have in the back of their mind and so on. So if you have any, please feel free to ask them now so I can address them at the end. Getting back to lapsing and relapsing, as I said, normalise. Well, I use the word normalise. What this means is that Tony needs to understand that change is difficult. I mean, change is difficult for all of us. And it's normal to attempt to change and then slip back into old habits. However, this does not mean that we can never change. It simply means that we're human and that change is difficult and does require several attempts. It's very unusual that a person decides to make a change from black to white. Again, we make several attempts until we feel we are successful. But we learn from each of those attempts, and then we learn things as to what to do and what not to do. So when I say normalize, I don't mean, well, I do mean that it's normal, but you just have to make sure that Tony doesn't get the message that it's okay. Even if it is okay, it's not kind of like permission to smoke again. So there is a very slight difference. All right, now moving on. Two support systems. You need to confirm that those support systems are in place, that they have worked, because you discussed this several weeks ago. Who are those people that are going to help Tony? Who are they going to be? What sorts of things is he going to be doing with each one of them? How they're going to do these things? How much is it going to cost? When is he going to do them? And so on. And don't forget to remind Tony if he ever feels, obviously he can ring you, hopefully. But again, you know, you may not be there at 8 o'clock at night. Actually, they close at 7. I take that back. The helpline, I think I may have mentioned it before, I think closes at 7. They operate 5 days a week from 11 till 7 in the evening. Let's say you've gone home, or let's say it's your day off and he can't speak to you. He can certainly ring someone on our cannabis helpline. So again, make sure that he's got that number. So yes, confirm all the support systems are in place and that he has some enjoyable things to do with some of his friends. It's extremely important for him to look to the future. He is doing all of this hard work and making all of this effort for a better future. And that future includes, as he said to you, more downtime, more holidays, more relaxation time. You've highlighted the things that he's looking forward to doing. You've discussed relaxation. You've discussed, you know, hot chocolates as a replacement, bowling, massage, snooker, whatever. Life is full of things to do. The future relates to his children and fatherhood and, you know, how he sees that and, you know, what kind of a role model he wants to play for his kids, and hopefully you've kind of touched on that a bit. And now, if he hasn't been smoking for the last couple of weeks, you know, he's got a clearer mind to see everything that he has gained. Okay, so while we're waiting for some questions, if there are any, what we have covered is in section one, you've introduced the book. You've stressed the need for homework. You've stressed that this is a collaborative intervention and that any time it's up for discussion and negotiation. You've explained what CBT is and how it is a treatment and what it does at its core is to change beliefs and thoughts that will hopefully change the behaviour that you want changed. You've discussed dependence and what that means. You've kind of prefaced it with, you know, do you know what I mean by dependence? And we measure dependence in relation to tolerance and withdrawal. And he's got some insight now into why his cannabis has gone from, you know, 20 years ago to being occasional to now, or then, hopefully 3 weeks ago, daily and 6 to 9 and so on. And how it grows, how tolerance grows. You've administered the questionnaires that make the very heart of the intervention, which was the SDS and the CPQ and the HRC, again, all downloadable from our website. You've given feedback on what that score means, and you've discussed what it means with Tony. And then very early in the piece, you raised the notion of a quit date that you have hopefully worked towards. In section two, you've checked in, you've assessed the level of motivation, and if it's still there, you continued on. You discussed the decisional balance, this is the pros and the cons. You've discussed the higher risk situations and identified two or three that you wanted to work on with him, and develop some strategies. You discussed preparing for change. Remember we said, okay, what are you going to do with your stash? What are you going to do with, you know, your implements and so on. You've asked him to look at the withdrawal section, to look at the monitor sheet, and you've planned that coming week with him that he's reducing or even quit, and obviously given him homework. And then we moved on to, you know, last week we covered, you know, section 3 and 4, where, as I've already discussed, we checked in again with motivation, obviously, discussed strategies for change, we reviewed the monitor sheet, very, very important. And as I said, these sections, seriously, can take 2 or 3 weeks. Cognitive restructuring, thought, self-talk, support systems, we've put those into place, we've checked that they're all working, discussed the 4 D's and how to use those D's, urge management, owning our own decisions, developed an emergency plan, discussed, you know, those behavioural self-management issues, as we said, anger, communication, sleep hygiene. You know, we've talked about setting limits and how to maintain a level of control, and hopefully, possibly, develop new strategies for anything that's kind of come up and establish better coping skills. And nothing changes if nothing changes. Lifestyle changes must be implemented before he stops seeing you. And make sure that withdrawal is not unpleasant or not as awful as people can make it, and just check for reduction in tobacco and perhaps suggest some patches and so on. And, you know, we finished off today with putting it all together and summarising it and checking and preparing, and then raised the notion of relapse prevention. You know, just to prepare someone. And again, it is not failure. All right. You have highlighted or given him a lot of resources. Again, I think I mentioned in previous in a previous webinar about the book called Quitting Cannabis that was written by us that he may want to buy in order to help him. And it basically covers everything that we've spoken about in these webinars. The website, the helpline, there's many, many things that he can use, or you can even use the fact sheets, obviously. Again, free resources for you. I just want to remind you of that. And really just end off or end up by thanking you so very much for attending these webinars. I look forward to your company in our next series.